And welcome to the American Civil War Museum's Homefront Education Series, where we bring the stories of our museum and the Civil War's collection straight to you. Now, we are here in Greenback, America, one of the temporary exhibits here in the American Civil War Museum's Richmond location. And I am joined by Dr. Chris Graham, the curator of the exhibit itself. And so we're going to talk a little bit more about Greenbacks. Isn't that right, Chris?
Yes, we are.
Great. So tell us where we are right now.
Okay, we're at a crucial point in the story, the real turning point in this story, and in many ways a turning point for the history of the American government in the Civil War.
Oh, okay.
So the United States is at war in 1861. It has to pay for that war.
Right.
It's estimated that the war is costing about $2.5 million a day. This is July, August, September 1861. And what's the way that Congress pays for its wars up to this point?
I'm assuming they're just raising taxes.
No. Would you be surprised that Americans have a problem with raising taxes? The traditional way that the United States pays for its wars and other economic crises is by borrowing money and borrowing it from banks. And up to a point, the Treasury Department had been successful in borrowing money from New York, Philadelphia, and Boston banks to pay for the war, and this is through the sale of bonds.
Right. Yeah, I'm just thinking, those are all those bigger banks that we were talking about earlier, not the smaller, less reputable ones.
That's correct. In late 1861, there's an issue, and it's kind of complicated, but it involves the bank's faith in the government's ability to pay back the money that it's borrowing, but also to some degree it has to do with those banks, as we learned from the antebellum period, they are accustomed to controlling the national economy. And they want to set the terms for lending the money. The Treasury Department does not want to do that any longer. And so there's an impasse, and the banks stop lending money in late 1861. And so we have a moment going into the winter, going into the New Year's holiday of 1861, in which the United States government can't get any more money, can't pay its bills, and therefore cannot continue to prosecute the war.
Wow. So we're talking about in the middle of a national crisis where they're fighting in order to keep the United States together and eventually to end slavery. The banks are no longer willing to actually give money to support or fund that effort.
That's correct.
Wow. That's incredible just to even kind of think of, but what does the government do in that case?
Well, there are several options. As you mentioned previously, taxing is an option. And the federal government does increase taxes on luxury goods and also institutes the first income tax in American history. So there is taxes, but the problem with taxes is that it would take up to a year to collect that revenue to pay for contractors, pay soldiers, pay for the continuation of the war. So that's not a great option.
Right.
They can sell more bonds. They do sell more bonds. Again, not enough.
Right.
In history, in Western history, a way for governments to raise money is to confiscate property.
Right.
The United States government is not going to do that. That's just not on the table. The final option is for the United States government to make its own money. And this was a controversial proposition. And it was put forward by this fellow here, a congressman from New York named Elbert Spaulding, who wrote the first version of the Legal Tender Act that was ultimately passed in February 1862.
So what does the Legal Tender Act do?
So what the Legal Tender Act does is that it empowers the Treasury Department to create legal tender notes, which are commonly known as greenbacks.
So that dollar that you had me pull out before, that's kind of coming out of that Legal Tender Act.
That is, in the Civil War, that would be a legal tender note.
Wow.
But the key is the legal tender notice on the back. Or on the front, in this case, in the Civil War period, it was on the back. But the thing is that in the former system, if you had a banknote, the premise was that you can go to that bank and turn in that banknote and get gold back for it. It wasn't always the case,
right?
But that's the idea. Legal tender notices, or greenbacks, were issued with no promise that you could go to the federal government and get gold for them. And so that creates two problems. It reduces the ability for people to trust the money, but it also increases the likelihood of inflation, terrible inflation, economy, extinction level event inflation.
Right.
And that's what the critics of the Legal Tender Act say is going to happen.
Right.
But men like Secretary of Treasury Salmon Chase and Congressman Spaulding say that it's more important that the government has money to pay to prosecute and win this war than the risk of destroying the economy through inflation.
Right. So as we were talking before, that those were, there were the large reputable banks, the ones that you could trust. Mm-hmm. There were the smaller banks that you could trust where you were in most cases, mm-hmm. but maybe not where you were going. And then now we've thrown this extra system in that's not even backed by the same way that those other banks are doing, whether they're large or small. And so the government is really asking people to just trust that this is going to work.
Right. And the novelty of the greenback is one thing. What's important is what follows after that in 1863 is that Congress passes the National Bank Act, mm-hmm. which in a sense creates a distributed national banking system. And so as we talked earlier about how those large banks in Philadelphia and New York controlled the economy and how much money was circulating, mm-hmm. now the federal government, through when Congress said how many greenbacks would be issued, they're the ones that are taking the leadership role in monetary policy in that way. Now, they don't entirely give it up. The National Bank Act empowers banks to issue national bank notes. And so there's a competition
right.
going forward between the Treasury Department and banks on who issues money and how much that money is valued at. But what's important is that now the federal government has an expanded and enlarged relationship in the economy, in banks, and in how citizens relate to those things.
Wow. So everyday people are now very much involved and connected with the federal government, like right in their very pockets.
That is correct.
Wow. Well, then as we continue to explore that and really get to the end of the exhibit, that's definitely something to keep in mind because it's definitely shaping the way that we relate to the federal government today.
Right.
Well, great. Well, then let's head on to
Hey, Joseph.
Yes, Chris.
Why are legal tenders like bullfrogs?
I don't know, Chris. Why are legal tender like bullfrogs?
Because they are greenbacks.
All right. Well, we're going to keep on going and move to our next segment here. But we'll join us again next time in Greenback America.